نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. Most of our speakers so far during these last 2 weeks of Holy Month of Ramadan focus on the point of morality, that the message of the month of Ramadan and the message of the Quran, the main message is perfection of human morality. And if we just keep fasting, avoiding from eating and drinking and smoking and everything, without a revolution in our spiritual values, in ethical and moral principles, then at the end of the holy month of Ramadan, what we gain is just suffering from hunger and thirst, while missing the point of Ramadan, which was a deeper moral vision and moral practice and a real change in the direction of our life. But Ramadan is for us really to change, it's not just. And it was said beautifully with the previous speaker that it's not just ritual, it's not just technicality, but the soul of the matter and the essence of the message of Ramadan. If we can establish Hayat and Tayyibah, a life that is beautiful, it is meaningful, it is purposeful, it is loving and respectful, it is responsible, then it is Hayat and Tayyibah. It can be achieved except through this exercise that we have in Ramadan. You know, sometimes you exercise how to swim in a small pool. When you learn how to swim, then you can go to lake and even to the ocean. This is the purpose of Ramadan, that we learn it in a, you know, limited way, but then we can apply it to a bigger society after Ramadan, and we are able to show a new personality, a new spiritual character after Ramadan. The Quran says to get to that point, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَى, this Surah Al-Shams, after 11 oaths, and Allah made 11 oaths in one chapter. This is the only chapter that Allah Himself makes oath 11 times. So Allah doesn't need to say, I swear. You and I do it because we want people to trust what we say. Because human being may lie, and in order to prove that I'm serious, I'm not lying, people make oath. Allah doesn't need to do that. Because He is astaghfirullah sadiqin, He doesn't lie. He is honest and truthful in His words, in absolute way. But the reason that He makes oath is to tell us that this subject is so serious, and the subject of the oath is extremely important. Like when He says, by time, for example, I swear by time. It's not that we believe, but to understand that time is important. Like when Fajr, when Subh, when Asr, when Layl, when Nahar. All of this, I swear by time, I swear by Fajr, I swear by afternoon, by morning, by day, by night. He wants us to appreciate the importance of time. Now after 11 times of Qasam, He says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّهَا. Only those who purify their soul, they are successful, and they are the one who gain hayatın tayyibe, that beautiful life and meaningful life, and achieving the path to perfection through purification of the soul. That is the message of this verse. And the center of that purified life is Allah Himself. If we can get marzat Allah, and you know that there is nothing in our life higher, there is no higher goal than getting Ridwan Allah. If we can get to the point that Allah is pleased with us and we are pleased with Allah, then nothing above that. That's what the Quran says. يَا أَيَّتَ النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّ ارْجِعِي إِلَى رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَةً. That you are pleased with your Lord, and your Lord is pleased with you. So out of every goal that we may have in our life, the best one, the highest one, the one that there is nothing above that, is to achieve Ridwanullah, satisfaction and pleasure of Allah. That means that this hayat and tayyiba that we are talking about, the meaningful life, is a life whose center is at tawheed. Allah is the center of that life. And that life is absolutely balanced. Allah yarhamu Shaheed al-Sadr, he said that the goal of the Sharia law, not the Sharia that's in the media and that Terry Jones was talking about, but the real Sharia has four purpose. And that is to bring balance in four areas of our life. Relationship between man and God, relationship between man and himself, relationship between man and men, the rest of the society, and relationship between men and universe. In the first one, irtibat, the connection between man and God through devotion and dedication, and the man himself, relationship between man and his own soul, is to establish domination over his temptation and his desires, that our desires are under control. It's not that we follow our feelings. You know, some teachers say, I follow my feelings. Well, follow your feelings. That is dangerous if you just want to follow our feelings in life, not to follow our intellect. Say, follow your intellect, not follow your feelings. Your feelings must follow that super authority that is human intellect. If things are under the supervision authority of our intellect, then we can get to the destination. But if we just follow our temptation and feeling, we don't know where we end up. And then the relationship between man and society, which is based on sympathy and solidarity and serving humanity. And finally, the relationship between man and nature, which is based on freedom, that enjoy the nature, enjoy the universe, but based on responsibility. You know, one of the tragedies in the social life is that, and especially many youth, that they like to be free, but they don't want to be responsible. And that's very dangerous. Just to be free, freedom without responsibility, it doesn't work. So Shaheed Sadr is saying that the goal of the Sharia to fix and to repair four areas of relationship between you and God, you yourself, you and human community, you and nature. And it's interesting that Quran gives us the best direction in all of these four journeys or four directions. Because Quran is the best guidance. Quran is the best book in the entire library of universe. إِلَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمِ The strongest, the most lightful, the most reasonable, the best guidance is the word of Allah, the words of wisdom. And every verse of this book, there are 114 chapters in the Quran. Let us just focus a little bit on the first chapter, Surah Al-Fatiha. Surah Al-Fatiha that has so many names. There are 20 names. We call it Surah Al-Fatiha and sometimes Surah Al-Hamd, right? That's basically we know about. But there are 20 names in tafsir like Al-Kanz, means treasure, or Qalb Al-Qur'an, or Asas Al-Qur'an, that this chapter is the foundation of the whole Qur'an. Umm Al-Kitab, Surah Al-Fatiha, this chapter is Umm Al-Kitab, means the mom of this book. That means it's like an index. Everything this in the Quran is summarized in Surah Al-Fatiha. How many times do we recite Surah Al-Fatiha in our prayer every day? How many? 10 times, right? Don't be shy. 10 times, because at least in the first 2 rakat, right? And we pray 5 times a day, and 5 times in the first 2 rakat, each time we recite 1 time, that means 10 times altogether, right? But then if we recite like mustahabbat, if we have extra prayer, we recite more Surah Al-Fatiha. Because in any prayer, Surah Al-Fatiha is base. The second surah is not like if you recite mustahabbat, like namaz al-shab, nafilat al-layl. You don't have to recite qul huwa allahu ahad or any. It's enough if you just recite Surah Al-Fatiha, right? Surah Al-Fatiha is basic in any prayer, except like Salat al-Janazah, that's different. But it's not only about prayer. When there is a wedding, we recite Surah Al-Fatiha. When there is a Aza, somebody dies, we recite Surah Al-Fatiha. When somebody is born, we are happy, we recite Surah Al-Fatiha. When somebody is sick, we go to the hospital, we recite Surah Al-Fatiha. When we want to bless something, we recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Isn't it amazing that we recite Surah Al-Fatiha hundreds and hundreds of times, but we never get tired of it? What is really the miracle about this book? I mean, any other words of wisdom, any other poetry, anything else, after you recite it and read it 1 time, 2 times, 10 times, 100 times, 1,000 times, you get tired and sick of repeating it. But what is it about this chapter that at least we recite it in our daily prayer 10 times, and then we keep repeating it at the time of happiness, at the time of sadness, in Irs, in Aza, in all different occasions, but still is fresh. Anytime we recite it, it's something new. This is about the miracle of the Quran. And then this chapter starts with Bismillah, in the name of God. That means really is important that anything that we start in life started Bismillah. Like in the first chapter that was revealed to the Prophet, Iqra Bismi Rabb. Recite in the name of your Lord. Because even if you get all the education in the world, but it's not Bismi Rabb. If your education is not in the name of God, if education is just has nothing to do, the center of this knowledge, the center of this education is not God. Tawheed has no space and no place in my knowledge, then that knowledge is dangerous. عِلْمٌ لَا يَنْفَى. That knowledge can turn to atomic bomb and kill millions of people, innocent people. If God is not there, knowledge can be so dangerous. Anything is dangerous without God. That's why I said, Bismillah. You want to even recite, you want to do work, you want to start a business, you want to make a decision, you want to make marriage, anything in your life, do it Bismillah. Allah. You know that Allah is the Arabic word for God. This is why even in English many times we don't say in the name of God, we say in the name of Allah, because it is hard to find even an English translation for Allah. Allah is Allah. When you say God, you can say it like single, you can say plural. You can say God, you can say gods, right? More than one God. But you cannot say Allahs, because we don't have more than one Allah. It's just one. Bism Allah. And this word, the name of Allah, which is the most personal name for God. The second is Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman is, like, you cannot, you know, call your son Ar-Rahman. You can call Rahim. We have Rahim. Somebody's called Rahim. But not Rahman. Because Rahman comes next to Allah, which is more personal name for God. But absolutely no Allah. We cannot call anybody Allah. That name is the absolute personal name of the Creator. And this name, Allah, is mentioned in the Quran 2,700 times. This name of Allah is mentioned in the Quran to tell us that the heart of this book is Tawheed. The subject of Quran is God Himself. This book is about God. This book is about Allah. This book is about unity. Unity of the Creator, unity of universe, unity of humanity. It is about unity. Anything that's about this unity comes from the shaitan. But unity comes from God. Bism Allah, who is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. You know, this beautiful talk that Hajar Yad has, talking about maghfirah and return to God, who is Allah, but Allah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, compassionate and merciful. And you know, there is a difference between Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, though both of them come from Rahm, from Rahma. But there is a difference between Ar-Rahmatul Rahmaniyya and Ar-Rahmatul Rahimiyya. They are different. Rahman is more absolute compassion that is for everyone. Like Allah invites everyone to a general reception, whether it's a mu'min or it's a kafir, or human being, animals. Everyone in this world can get benefit of this universe, the moon, the sun, the stars, the galaxies, the oceans, the mountains, the trees, the fruits, the food, water, weather, everything is for everyone. It's Ar-Rahman, it's not limited to anybody. But Ar-Rahim is a special mercy for those who follow certain principles and they gain certain goals in their life. Those who follow, those who submitted, those who chose their will to be will of God, that say, your will is my will and my will is your will. All I want is what you want, nothing else. So we have Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. You know that in this chapter, first of all, in every chapter, we start with Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, except one chapter, chapter number 9, that doesn't start with Bismillah, but then we have this in another chapter, extra Bismillah in the middle of chapter, that altogether 114 times Quran says Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Why is it so? Because the heart of the matter in Islam is Ar-Rahman. You're a Christian, they said God is love. In Islam, they say God is mercy. So we are saying the same concept, that the heart of the matter in Islam is Ar-Rahman. Islam is about Rahman. If you go, once I counted in the Quran, the word Al-Maghfirah, which is forgiveness, Ar-Rahman, which is mercy, the word Sabr, which is patience, and also Al-Mahabba, which is love. I realize that in Quran more than 1,000 times these terms have been repeated. Ar-Rahman, Al-Maghfirah, Al-Sabr, and Al-Mahabbah. That all are talking about the same thing, about love and compassion and mercy. 1,000 times. But how many times the Quran talk about the ghadab, means anger of God? Because some people, they think that, you know, more Mormon, you should be more angry, and, you know, you see all these Salafis with a long beard, and they think that's all Islam about. And the longer your beard, the deeper your religion. As a matter of fact, much longer, it shows more foolishness rather than faith. It's not really that, you know, you have like one foot of beard, that means that you are more Muslim than somebody else. There is, in Islam, there is everything balanced, even your beard. I mean, how you sleep with like 1 meter beard? I mean, how you wanna handle that when you go to bed and you wanna, you know, live a normal life? I mean, it's just, Islam is a religion of common sense, rationality. So don't add all of this. Only 15 times the word ghadab in the Quran. Can you imagine the anger? That God is angry, not angry like you and I get angry for any silly things. God does not get angry. God is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He is loving and compassionate. God doesn't get angry. So what does mean to see and to say that God is angry? That is the time that we do something that we deprive ourselves from God's love and mercy. When we make a wall between us and God, when we go through sin and separate ourselves from our Creator, this separation brings anger, brings curse and condemnation, not because God got angry, but because we got away, we stayed away from God. That is the point. And even 15 times. And that 15 times is not just about God anger. It's talking about people get angry and other things. But I'm saying with all together, only 15 times the word anger, but 1,000 times love, forgiveness, mercy, and patience. So when we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, when we say in the Salah, be careful that you are saying, you are making a big statement. Some would say, oh, I wish I knew Ismul Adam, the biggest name of God, that I make a miracle. Well, so just say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is the biggest name of God. But it depends who says it. Who says it? Like if Jesus says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and you can make a miracle and raise somebody from dead to rise, that's all he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, nothing more. But why doesn't work when we, you and I say a thousand times, doesn't do anything? Because this Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim should come from a purified heart. Like Jesus, like Muhammad, like Moses, like Sayyidah Fatima, like Sayyidah Zainab, like Ahlul Bayt, like Imam Ali. When they say it, it makes a difference. Because really the focus, the understanding, the soul, the purity behind that statement is so strong that it brings so much light and so much power and so much energy that can change the world. So how much we apply this to our life? When you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, huh? How many times is it? Allah is Rahim. What about yourself? Can we be Rahim? I mean, we should be Rahim too. Is it only Allah should be Rahim? What about you? What about me? Because the Prophet said, تَخَلَّقُوا بَأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ. Apply the characters of God to your soul. If Allah is As-Sami'ah, isn't it that one of the qualities of God is As-Sami'ah? So you and I should be As-Sami'ah. We should listen. Many times people don't listen. You know, husband and wife, they talk and everybody is talking and nobody listening. You know, during the argument, she's talking loud and he's talking loud and nobody is listening. Everybody just talk. So what happened to listening? If we don't listen, then we cannot solve any problem. God is Samir. You and I have to be Samir. We have to listen. God is Basir. He has vision. We have to open our eyes. Many times we don't open our eyes. You know, somebody is sleeping, and you know, if he's really sleeping, then you can wake him up. But somebody just closes his eyes, he's not sleeping, closing his eyes, and you tell like he's sleeping, you cannot wake up this guy because, you know, he just, the whole thing is fake. Sometimes people, they close their eyes, they do not want to see the truth. What can you do? All this media, all of this news, all these fake things going on, because there are people who do not want to open their eyes. Or sometimes they open only one eye. God gave us two eyes, not one eye. That means that you see the material and the spiritual. You see this side and that side. Don't have only one eye. Open your eyes, both of them, so you can have the whole picture of what is going on. God is Shakur, means when we do something, God appreciates. But we don't have appreciate for one another. The culture of appreciation, love us. What happened to appreciation? What happened to consciousness? How many times you heard your mom telling your dad that you never said thank you, right? You never said I love you. You never appreciate anything that I did for you. Or vice versa, you know. Expectation of the husband telling his wife that I do all this work and working so hard 24/7 and you never say thank you. We have to. Because God is Shakur, God is appreciative. And we have to appreciate too. So there are qualities like God is Hakim, He is wise. We have to have wisdom in our life. He is Ghafoor, He is forgiving. We have to be forgiving too. So when you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, we cannot be Rahman, but we can be Rahim at least. That means that show some mercy to ourselves, to our spouse, to our parents, to our children, to our neighbors, to humanity in general. Unfortunately, it is gone. You see how world is, how much mess and tragedy and brutality. Ar-Rahma is gone, love is gone, consciousness is gone, appreciation is gone. It's the culture of worse than the culture of animals. That people kill each other, people eat each other. People show no respect for one another's lives and dignity. That is against the philosophy of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Then we go ahead and say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. What does that mean? All praise belongs to Allah. Because of what? Because He is Rabbul Alameen. Wow! You know when you say in Salah, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, or sometimes you say, how are you? You say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Really, this is a beautiful answer. Rabbul Alameen means owner of the whole world. You know, somebody might be Rabbul Bayt, like you own a house, right? You are Rabbul Bayt. You have a car, in Arabic they say Rabbu Sayyara, right? Car means Sayyara in Arabic, right? What if you have a ship, what they call you? Rabbu Safina, right? Safina in Arabic means a ship. You have a boat. You have like a qasr, you have a palace. You have Rabbul Qasr. Like this, William and Kate, they have a palace, Kensington, right? Now everybody in the world, what is going on? For month and month, they're waiting that for this baby, and everybody says, oh, is it boy or girl? And now, like they don't know, have no technology to know, they want to wait for the last minute. We don't know if they themselves know it, or just for publicity. Or now, what about his name? The whole world now, you know, Majlis Azar just to find a name now for this baby. If it is girl, this name is a boy, this girl. And now already the baby, before his birth, he is a monarch. But they say that he is the third generation and he's going to be already, no election, no vote, he already is a monarch, right? If another country does the same thing, everybody complains. What happened? They have no election, no voting, nothing. But now this is England, like Mahd al-Hurriya is the heart of democracy, and you don't need to be elected or be voted. You are king before even you are born. You know, sometimes they say, why Imam Jawad was like 9 years he became Imam, at least he was 9. Imam al-Mahdi was 5 years when he became Imam, but now in this case the boy was king before he was born and nobody says anything. And you have problem about that? Just because you are Rabbul Qasr, because you have a palace, you have power, then you get all this attention. What about thousands and millions of other babies who are born every day in homeless and hungry houses or in the war areas and battle zones that the moment they are born, they are attacked by missile and they have to suffer till the end of their life or they are dying right away and no one cares? Is it like they are less in the eyes of God? And if somebody was born in a palace or big hospital, because coming from a powerful and strong, you know, money family or palace family or military and mighty family, then this person is like, wow, that's exception. That's not how it works in the justice of God. Don't waste your time and give all these praises, all this media for anything else except Allah. Focus your praise towards Allah, who is Rabbul Alameen. It's not just Rabb of this place or that building or this village or that town or this country or the planet of the earth. I mean, what is the whole planet of earth compared to the solar system? And what is solar system compared to this galaxy? And what is our galaxy compared to universe? And now we are fighting and so much excited for nothing and so much angry for nothing. It's really, if we read Surah Al-Fatiha and we understand it in every prayer, we understand our position much, much better. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. We praise Him because He is Rabbul Alameen. Rabbul Samawati wal Ard, the heavens and earth. Under His domination, He is Nur al-Samawati wal Ard. Allahu Nur al-Samawati wal Ard. Subhanallah. God is the light of all these heavens and the earth. That means that if there is this connection between God, if there is no light in universe, there is nothing. Can you live in darkness all the time? It's so much chaotic, isn't it? If there is no light, how can we live? It's totally big mess. Without His light, the whole world is full of mess and chaos and confusion. He is Nur al-Samawat wal-Ard. Al-Hayyu al-Qayyum, the only one whose life is independent. Our life is dependent, vulnerable, weak. But He is Al-Hayy al-Qayyum. He is living, but His life depends on Himself, doesn't depend on anybody else. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. He is the Lord of the whole universe. And then again we say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Why? We already said Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, didn't we? When we say Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, we said it. Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Then we said Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, right? Praise to the Lord of the world. And then we again said Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Why do we repeat the same thing again? Well, if you really think about it, that you already were talking about a powerful Lord who is the Lord of the world. He is the owner of human beings and animals and jinns and the angels and this planet and the whole universe and this world and hereafter. You are talking about such a big, big owner and Rab. You may think that somebody with all this power should be a big, big dictator. I mean, people get a little money and little might and little thing, they are so arrogant and they have so much ego just because yesterday they didn't have money, today they have like, you know, a few dollars. Get arrogant. But Allah, having all this power, all this treasure, but He still is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He stays to be compassionate and merciful, despite of all this power and everything that He has. Then He says, Malik Yawm al-Din. You can say Malik Yawm al-Din or Malik Yawm al-Din. He is the ruler of the day of resurrection. Wow. Can you imagine in such a short prayer, we have started from beginning, the origin of the world, that is Allah. And then the end of the world, again, Malik Yawm al-Din. He was not only the creator of this world, but he is the end and the purpose and the ruler of the day of resurrection. Because that means that no matter where you are, who you are, you have to return to him. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. You are all those fashionette, like shiny, famous celebrities, California stars, and they move, and all this media and all this other, you think they never die. Wow. No matter who you are a king, or you are an ayatollah, or you are imam, or whoever, you have to return. And the Quran says, أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. No matter which direction you face, Allah is there. Allah is everywhere. Don't even say, where is Allah? If you say, where is Allah? You are limiting Allah. Looks like Allah is limited to a place. You say, where? You are saying that like Allah is somewhere and he's not somewhere else. It is wrong to say even where. Allah is absolute presence all over the time and place and existence of this world and hereafter. So, even if you go to Quran says, وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجِ مُشَدِّدًا. Even if you go to Burj al-Khalifa. Do you know where is Burj al-Khalifa? Who knows? Which country has Burj al-Khalifa? There is a big, so far, the biggest tower of the world that has 160 stories. Where is that?
Dubai.
Dubai, right? They call it Burj al-Khalifa. Khalifa. That's the Burj al-Khalifa. If you go on the floor number 160, be careful, the death can come even over there. The malakul maut is coming even that high. Don't think if you are on the top of that tower, the angel of death cannot have access to you. No matter where you are, he is going to come. There is, of course, in the Grand Zero, they are making another tower. You know how many stories is that? 200. So it's going to be the biggest in the world. And ahead of the way, but Allah is saying that you will return to the ruler of resurrection no matter what. Then إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. If that is God and this is your power, only you we worship. Who else deserves to be worshipped except that this powerful entity called Allah, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. Who else can we appeal for assistance? If I get a chance, inshallah, tomorrow, because Sayyid Jawad al-Qazwini was supposed to come here today, and he apologized for one day to be late. He's been speaking for YMA, and tomorrow night he starts his lecture here. He's a very dynamic lecturer. Some of you who follow out his lectures on YouTube and internet here and there, you know that. And he promised to dedicate his talks for the rest of Ramadan, inshallah, focusing on 12 Imams. Because so many of us, we call ourselves Shia and followers of Ahlul Bayt. And if somebody asks about Ahlul Bayt, many of us, we have no idea. We know a little bit about Imam Ali, and we know about Ashura and Imam Hussein. And then when we go to, what about Musa ibn Ja'far, Al-Imam Al-Hadi, Al-Imam Al-Jawad, Al-Imam Al-Askari? Many of us have no clue even to say one thing about their life, about their wisdom, about their message, about their style, about anything. And he is going to focus each night, as he promised me, in one imam and explain the life of one of the Masumin. That would be a wonderful presentation. And then if I got a chance, I would go through the rest of this chapter, because I don't want to prolong it more than this. I wish I could complete this. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. Maybe if I get a few minutes each night, I just go and a little bit explain about this. I know that this is really a chapter that I was talking about it for 3 months years back. For 3 months I was talking about this chapter, so it's very, very deep. But even if you want to summarize it, it takes more than just one time. Saying that, we get a little bit time to, inshallah, go to the Dua al-Iftitah. And the next time that we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, we realize that it's more than just recitation. It's not only technicality of this verse that, oh, you are not reciting it right. Your tajweed is not good. You have to say, wala dhalin. Well, those who, you know, kill people and eat people, they say it much better than we do. But it's not about just how to say it, how to understand it. So many people, they say, غَيْرَ الْمَغْضُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. But the bottom line, at the end of their life, they realize that they are مَغْضُوبِينَ and they are ضَالِّينَ. They didn't realize that they were مَغْضُوبِينَ, although they were saying it correctly. Then we find that, oh, when the Imam said, وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ, you have to say, Ameen. You know, the Sunni brothers and sisters, they say Ameen when the Imam says wala dhalin. They don't have to say it, it's not wajib. As a matter of fact, we, the follower of the Jafari school of thought, they don't say that. We say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen when the Imam says wala dhalin. We quietly, we may say, we don't have to, but we can say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Our brothers, they are saying you have to say Ameen, and they think if you don't say Ameen, you miss your prayer. And I was saying to one of them, I say, where is this Ameen is coming from? This word is not even in the Quran. In the entire Quran, you don't have word of Ameen. And you now you brought it and you included it in the prayer, and you say if you don't say it, then you lost your prayer. It's not really. Surah Al-Fatiha is much more than just tajweed and technicality and how to say it. Yes, we have to learn and say it rightly and recite it good. But we don't have to, we shouldn't stop there. We should go to the meaning of this chapter, and inshallah, if I get a chance, I will explain to you that how this chapter can fix our relationship with our Lord, with ourselves, with our community, with humanity, and with universe, inshallah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. You have some time to participate in the al-iftitah, inshallah, Salat al-Maghrib, before we start the iftar. If Hajj Riyaz doesn't have any explanation, then that's the service for tonight. Thank you very much, brothers and sisters, for your patience.